Hey, this is the Christopher Complex. We got another show for you today. We're talking to artist Robert Danadov. This interview, we are speaking to him about his art, his influences, the reason why he paints, how he sees life through art. I think in this interview, you're going to get a lot of different insight that can be applied to a lot of different things in your life. Again, as you know, the podcast is about learning, conversation, how to get better, my way of a success talk. That seems to be a very, very growing conversation in the world right now. And this is not so much an interview. It's more of a conversation. Like the other conversations on this podcast, we just get a chance to talk to him, talk to these individuals, and learn from them. You know, we can learn from celebrities, and I think we can learn more from people that are not celebrities or just celebrities in their own community or in their industry. And when we spoke with Robert Danadov, he has a show coming up in March. We'll talk about that. There's also a part two to this podcast. We spoke about his passion. We spoke about his view when it comes to art, the state of art. We spoke about spiritualism, ancestry, and how if you're involved in something and how to continue to stay connected to the ancestry. We spoke about being connected. Life is not just, you know, what's right here in front of you. It's about so many things. It's also about connection. So this is a very, very good conversation. You're in the room with us, and we also had some wine, and we'll have some more artist talks and some more other people, all kinds of different industries. We're just gonna be trying to learn as much as we can so we can get as best as we can, be perfect, as it says. So enjoy the interview. If you want to leave some comments, they are welcome. If you have negative things to say, we'd rather not be bothered with that. We want to keep it positive. We're trying to get to as many people as we possibly can so people can learn, grow, and get better at what they love and what they want to do. Again, this is the Christopher Complex. You can hit me up at the Christopher Complex on Twitter. Please subscribe. Please share. Please share with someone that may get some nuggets out of this. There's a part two. We'll talk about that at the end. Okay, we're with Robert Danadov, artist, painter. And we're going to find out so many and just a whole bunch of things. This is a friend of mine. We reared our kids up together at the same school in Brooklyn. Our relationship started, I guess, on the playground.
Playground, yes.
Yeah, right?
The little kids get together, bringing the big kids.
And then I think we had a crisis in the school and somebody said, Chris, you need to be the PTA president. And Robert told me, yeah, go do it. And then we started talking about conspiracy theories, Netflix, the government, the Illuminati, the crazy people.
Yes. Yeah.
And all of that stuff. So welcome, Robert.
Thank you, man. Thank you.
So I know you're an artist. We've hung out. We've had our kids hang out. We've had a lot of instances where, you know, we just had fun over wine and Halloween and stuff like that.
Right.
You got a new show coming up. Tell us a little bit about the concept of the show. Anything that you can give us right now. We know it's still in development.
Well, the show is going to be March, middle of March, in Gallery MC, it's called 52nd Street and 10th Avenue. That's MC, meaning Macedonian Center. This is kind of connected with Macedonia, which place where I'm coming from. And it's going to be two man shows with one other colleague, which is Steven Balog, which is Hungarian.
Okay.
And as we're coming from similar, you know, same area, so the theme gonna be kind of connected with the where we're coming from, you know, the darkness from the Balkans, actually the Balkans.
Right.
He also was from the time when regime when you cannot paint what you want.
Wow.
So you was prosecuted for what you can paint, so you have to be secret shows, this and that. So
wow.
That's why he came here, I think.
Wow.
I wasn't prosecuted, but I came anyway, yeah. And but the roots is that the darkness, volcanic, is what's keeping us together, you know.
But see, that's
and
the thing.
The show together.
That's
nicely.
The thing. You never told me about that. Maybe I didn't even ask because we so wrapped around our kids. You have a beautiful daughter and wife, right. And then I have two, and we just always are focused on them. But that's actually awesome, and I just feel that a lot of people can relate to that. And through art, you just probably helped me explain a lot of your art too.
Yeah, because, sure.
Like, are you coming from that place most of the time? Is it?
All what I do came from there. It's still there, and which amazed me. I'm so many years here in the United States. I don't have any, almost not one or two or three paintings inspired by, let's say, New York or the so-called energy and stuff.
New York is kind of corny right now.
But just like, but you have this American energy, whatever. You
right.
know? You have so much, so many artists, you know, blossom here or whatever. And many people are inspired by it, starting with pop art, expressionist, post-expressionist, etc., etc. I never had that. I could never paint Campbell soups or buildings or whatever.
Right, right, right.
Always, whatever I did, if it came from through the DNA from Macedonia and putting right. it out here, because I believe every artist is product of his geographical origin. The real one, so you cannot change that. Like, you know, you come right. from Africa, you can act Swedish, right?
Exactly.
That.
Exactly.
So that's why I'm saying, even if I come here so many years, still the roots, DNA, is much more stronger than temporary fashions or whatever. Also, United States is very, very, very young place, you know.
It is. It's 200 years.
There's nothing.
That's nothing. And it's still trying to find its identity. It's like when you look at Trump and all the stuff that he's swinging us through. If you're a Trump supporter, all the things that Obama swung us through, we're still trying to get our identity as the United States.
Yeah.
But then you have a state like New York, and then you have a city like New York City, and that identity constantly changes. So, like earlier I said, New York is a little corny right now.
Right.
I think people like you actually make New York what it's supposed to be. Because when I grew up in New York, dude, I mean, I could put together the best menu on the planet. I can go and get Polish sausage. I can go get Jewish bakery. Right. I can go get Italian pasta that's real, not the box stuff. I can go get soul food. I can go get all these different kinds of foods and put it on one plate and literally say that's New York. So when you talk about your experience coming from the Balkans and Macedonia and bringing it here, and I know how your paintings look. And just so you guys know, when you're listening to this podcast, you will be seeing some of the paintings go by.
Uh-huh.
When you see the art that you're creating and the statement that you just made, it speaks to me a little louder. It's like it's like you've been playing the guitar ever since I've known you. But what you just said, you just plugged it into the amp.
Right.
And it just got real sonic, you know?
Getting clearer. Right.
Right. I mean, your art is very, very sonic. I'm an auditory person, so you know, I can look at it and just see there's a lot of blues in there, there's jazz.
You can compose.
Yeah.
Looking up.
Yeah. I can see.
Like a movie.
That.
Music, yeah.
But that's cool. So the other gentleman that's doing this show in March, same place he's coming
from. Same place, yeah. No, he's coming from Hungary.
Oh, okay, Hungary,
that's
right.
That's a country.
But same kind of
it's
environment.
It's a Balkan. Yes, that's that area, let's call it. Well, I come was called Yugoslavia first. Before the Civil War, they have a 90s, if you remember.
Yeah, I do.
It consists of six republics, living great, happy people, and all of a sudden some opportunists politically and religiously decide this is not good. We can, after the Tito death, we can use that for our own benefits and gains, so they create this war when everything fall apart. So many people lost their home, lives, etc., moved around. It's like happening all over the world, actually. Divide and conquer, right?
Or yeah, rule. Divide and conquer, exactly. Yeah.
But this is inside thing, you know, which is much more hurtful.
But then that's also colorful, too, because you know, as a black person, our divide and conquer was, you know, like more the diaspora of the slavery.
Right.
We were taken from something. Mm-hmm. I never seen what you talk about, divide and conquer inside that.
Inside. It's like imagine now Texas and all those. First, you fight nicely, kill each other in the United States, then they become their separate countries, and you need passport to go to Texas or Iowa. That's how it's in my country now. Wow. I need a passport to go in my place where it was my country before, the other republics like Serbia, you know, Croatia, you have other places, which I still don't feel that. I still feel Yugoslavian, you know. Now they're all called by their own republic, but that's still place.
For you as a younger person, that's just a different town in the same state or same country.
Right.
You know, so that, I'm quite sure that's what you're trying to say and stuff like that.
Right. And the problem is now with the new generation, the young ones, they didn't know what was before.
I think so that's across the board. I was with a gentleman the other day, and we were talking about some music, and it's funny that when we were talking about music, I'm like, you want this kind of sound, but it seems like your generation doesn't appreciate that sound until you get into a trap, until you get stuck. And he wanted to create a sound for his music, and that's when he decided, okay, I gotta go backwards into history and find out what I can pull from.
Exactly.
The good thing is that the kind of artist that you are, you already got something to pull from. And I think you're right with that generation. Maybe we made it too good for them.
It is too, or too bad.
Yeah, maybe.
I think with the technology, it's too bad.
Yeah. There's a gentleman, I don't know if you ever heard of him. His name is Ray Dalio. He's a big time hedge fund. He's probably the best in the world. I think he's the best in the world. He just came out with a book. And in his book, I was listening to it the other day, and he was talking about you have to have some kind of struggle. Because it's like the human body, the human brain just falls apart, and you got mush.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
So when I was talking to this gentleman about his music and how he could get new sounds, and he's like telling me, oh, I want this sound, and he's making it. It's like someone walking up to you and saying, well, you know, I want my music to sound like Picasso. You ever heard of Picasso? And he's telling me, have you ever heard of Picasso? It's like, are you on the juice or something? You know. But yeah, I agree with you on that. It sounds like the generation now, they just detached. I don't know for what reason.
Detached from the nature, number one. Detached from the tradition.
Yeah.
You can't have anything new. It's nothing exists new which is not connected with the tradition. You know, you can't invent, you know, something. How you call that? With a substance. It doesn't have a roots in the back there. You know.
Exactly.
Because rock and roll, whatever you have, the music go back to the blues and before the blues, gospels and who knows what kind of Gregorian chants? Maybe who knows?
Yeah, it could be just that simple.
But there is no new, in a sense, you know, revolutionary or let's destroy the old one.
It's impossible.
It's impossible. It's you can't make new music.
It's impossible. I think we were talking the other day about the masters that came before us and how even though they're now our ancestors, we talk to them and we say to them, okay, how do we get past this piece? How do we get past this part? I don't know if the new generation even considers that. who's that artist? I know who the artist is, but for the people, who's that artist? Who's one of the artists that you have in the room with you when you paint? If you don't mind.
Oh, this one?
Yeah.
Titian.
Right. So his spirit is magnified in this room.
Yes, exactly.
And
because we are connected, like it or not. Everything is energy and spiritual,
right?
And probably these people are watching us from some kind of different dimension. I feel that sometimes, you know, when I go in my school of painting is through them in a museum, observing, thinking what they did, and make a conversation about how something is done and why it's done. And they can talk if you listen, you know?
They do. And a lot of people can't get that.
Exactly.
And I think the reason why people can't get it... So some people will say, and you know, the reason why we do this podcast is to give people insight from everyone, because I think everybody should can learn from anyone.
Right.
You know, you have your lessons. Like, I just learned some stuff just talking to you for the last 12 minutes, and it's crazy. Exactly. But so, if we are in tune to that realm, I think their residue or part of their spirit is still in the form that they presented themselves at that time.
Exactly.
And you could say, like, you know, when I make music, sometimes I'll say, Prince, I can't make this guitar do what it do. And then you just kind of stay quiet, and then you just it's like your imagination is, you know, you could mistake it as an imagination, but it's not. It's him. It's actually him saying that spirit, because, you know, we think so much body is contained. Spirit is just quick. When they say it's quick, it's everywhere. That's what it means. And he'll just come and he'll say, okay, you know, you need to play this in A flat. And I'm quite sure you had the same experience when you get stuck.
Yes, of course. How he will solve this. And then all his works come in your mind, you know. He give you his menu of pickings and dishes.
Right.
And you see something, you know, click, you know. Because this composition, I did not really invent it. This is an experience from the centuries of other people's work.
Right.
This is what I say, DNA, you know. Nothing new. I mean, everything is done. This is the same pigment they use, you know.
Right.
Just only now, there is a 7 notes in a scale, right?
12.
Or 12, whatever.
Yeah, 12.
But with those 12, you can make symphonies, you can make...
So much.
So much.
Quincy Jones even said that.
Exactly. Like, I use few pigments, less and less like that. I'm learning from the old masters. You see, this portrait of his is like 3 colors. You know, burnt amber, raw amber or something, and white, and that's it. You don't need much. And what's the color? The color is little pigment, earth. You mix it with little oil. And then through this magic of alchemy,
exactly,
you make
exactly
something new.
Exactly. You know, things are universal. Yeah. So I was having the problem learning how to play the guitar because I kept playing the same thing. I was in a box. And I didn't even know being in that box was actually a good thing, because B.B. King had his own box and he made 500,000 records with that same pattern. But I remember talking to my guitar teacher. He's downtown. He lives right down the block from you, actually, downtown in Barham Hill. And he said to me, he said, Chris, when you make a guitar solo, you don't need all them notes. You just need 3 or 4 notes and just talk through the guitar. Say something.
Right.
Make each one of them notes count. I have a guitar at home, and it's signed by Les Paul, the guy that actually made the guitar. I got blessed by one of my friends.
Nice.
He's a genius when it comes to audio engineering. And when I met Les Paul, right before he died, he said to me, he said, he signed the guitar, says, keep rocking.
Right? Yeah.
And then he said to me, make sure every note counts. He says, I don't want you to be one of these guys that play 5,000 notes and we don't know what you said. And I was like, holy smoke.
Yeah. He said, you can bush it. You can trick some note, you know, leave it out. Everything with those few notes, you know, there are few, but they can be perfect. You know, you can make a big speech with a few words, you know. And that's what I'm talking to this whenever I teach some art, you know. Yeah, I'm telling them the same thing. You don't need me. Where you see so many colors, you know. That's also to blame today's industry. They make millions of different colors. That's for sale, for business. You don't need. Same the entertainment, like you say, for this million different, how you call that, things which, how do you say that? You know, the youngs, they get every day with informations, with images, bombarded and stuff.
What, the social media stuff?
Or? Social media, whatever.
Uh-huh.
So much information, so many images, and on hand you don't see anything.
You know what?
It's become blue.
It's true. And going back to the example that you said, I remember I went to Art and Design High School in New York.
Yeah.
I don't know if you've seen it. Maybe they had it when you was a kid. But there used to be this TV magazine. And there used to be like this frog in the magazine at the end of the magazine, mm-hmm. and it would be like a contest. And it says, draw this frog and send it to us as a contest. Uh-huh. And if you win, we'll give you art lessons.
Oh, really?
So we would draw this frog. Me and my brother, we kept drawing the frog or the little toad and stuff like that. And the funny thing about it is that you didn't know that you were actually getting good.
This is the sound of wine.
The sound of wine. We're drinking a
nice Primitivo from Puglia. Or here they call it Zinfandel, I guess.
Griffon. Primitivo.
Very good. Good
price. Yeah, very good wine. And paper cups, by the way. So I went to art school, and I remember, going back to what you just said, we was in the basics.
Right.
They taught us how to sharpen a pencil.
Uh-huh.
Which was like, they asked, do you know how to sharpen a pencil? And we were like, of course. And they said, no, you don't. Taught us how to sharpen a pencil with a razor. Mm-hmm. And then they asked that simple question, what is a primary color?
Mm-hmm.
And we were like, brown, green, and all this other stuff. And he was just like, no, it's only three colors. And I agree with you. When we were in art design, and that was like in 1986, they taught us, you make your color.
Right.
If you got the primaries and black and white,
that's all you need.
You can make your color. You just have to be patient.
All right.
And you have to know.
Mix and feel.
And you make your color.
Yes.
Now you go and you have 15 different grades. It's like, what the hell?
And you don't learn like that. You know?
No, you don't. You don't. And
I don't learn like that.
It's like the gentleman, you know, I was helping with his music and he just wanted to cut and paste the damn thing. And just oh, just put this on top of it and just call it that, what it is.
And there is no quick road to the quality, you know. Like I say, before today, you know, you can go to art school and get, I don't know, a diploma in 4 years. You call Master of Fine Art, 18, 19 years old. Before 4 years, you can't even call yourself painter, you know? This is so damn hard profession. People can't see that because it's trivialized, you know? It's much more difficult than medical profession. Doctor to become, you need a book. You have a book, so everything is written down, you learn it, you do it. I give you blank canvas and tell you compose here. Let's see,
that
what's more difficult?
Easy.
A doctor or a painter?
A painter.
It is.
It's just that the doctor gets more credit because he can save a life sometime.
Yeah, but obviously not doing it. You can learn that. Like, my point was, you can't really learn that. You know, you have to be kind of, you have this gift. That's the English good word. You know, you can't go to school, decide today, and I'm going to be Picasso, go to school, I want to paint, you know. Or I'm going to go to music school and become Jimi Hendrix. Jimi Hendrix is one, right?
Yeah.
How you become Jimi Hendrix? You can't. And it's funny, even if you become like him, what is this? Two Jimi Hendrixes? That's ridiculous too.
That is. I'm glad you said that.
You have to be you.
Right.
If you have it.
Yeah.
If you have it, you can acquire it in school or somebody else. Even if you go to the master, if you don't have that little thing fire there, what the hell are you going to do with you?
And I like what you said the other day. I came to visit you. You said, I said, what's going on? And you said drudgery.
Yeah, it is work.
A lot of people don't like the word work.
Art is work.
Yeah.
Art is work.
Because, for instance, I've seen a lot of your work. And what most people don't understand about art is, you have so many elements, and you can apply these elements to life. So if you're listening out there and you're not an artist and you need to get something out of this, if Robert does a painting, it's got to be color, perspective, shadow, light. And you may put somebody's face in color, but you use green, but that person interprets it as, oh, he's a brown person, or he's a white person. But the light that I saw at that one little spot was green, or was blue, or was red, and the accumulation of all of that gave me this person's face. And so when you look at it, you have a painting like this that we're looking at, and you have perspective that's not going out of perspective. And a lot of people can't even get that. You know, just that part alone. Yeah. Like, So how did you break down over your life how to get these different parts? Like, did you spend a lot of time on perspective, and did it kick you in your ass? And,
who, me?
Yeah, you.
No, I don't even believe in perspective.
Okay.
It's all natural. If you can see here, I manipulate the shadows. If I need shadow here, I put it. Even the sun is not coming here. If I need it here for the composition, I put it there. You know, even it's not natural way. For the harmony of a whole painting, I can put the damn shadow where I feel, not where the sun is, you know.
Right,
I got some rules and stuff. Mm. Perspective I use if it's help, again, the whole feeling of the composition of the painting. Not because you should, but this is, you know, come with the time and stuff, you know.
Right.
When you learn all your elements, you know, and you can manipulate it any way you want.
Right.
It's like a good guitarist, you know. After a while, maybe he doesn't even think about notes or anything. He twists and manipulates all these notes and all this knowledge for the final effect. So it's same here. Now, I play the tango, but I don't think about the feet.
Yeah.
You know, you go in ecstasy and stuff. So all these little things which are technical are just means to the end, you know.
Mm-hmm.
All these pickings of the guitar and stuff. I'm not even thinking about. You see, when you paint, really, you don't think.
You know, that's a very famous statement. Don't think. So I was playing the other day. I was making some music, and you spend time learning your chords. You spend time learning your scales, but when it's time to play, you just play.
Play.
You don't.
You go in ecstasy, you lose yourself, you have to lose yourself.
Yeah, like, yeah, you're right, you go in ecstasy.
Yeah, you have to ecstasy, that's what it is. If you're not, then it's dry music or whatever.
Yeah.
Like a blues, you know, or when I listen to those Zydeco people, how you call that music down?
Yeah,
Zydeco,
yeah.
You see,
that's all spirit.
Also, the church,
that's all spirit.
The black people in the down south, man, that's a spirit.
That's all spirit. That's what got
the
me.
Shakers.
Yeah, that's what got me into music. My grandmother used to take me to the church, a very famous church called Brown Church in Selma, Alabama. We used to go, and I remember as a little kid walking out of it, I was just like, "What the fuck?"
Yeah.
Just like, yeah. Wow, did you just see what happened with grandma? And she's like, oh, that's every day. No, it's not. Because it's not easy to do that.
And that's the studio, that church, and that's the artist who's shaking. It's the same happening here. That's how it has to be. If you have a good painting you want to make, you have to go to the same process. Like your people in that church, you know.
Right.
Otherwise, painting gonna be mediocre. You know, in art you have just two types of painting and artwork, good and bad. Nothing, nothing in between.
I
call
that.
It. You have a stillborn baby and healthy born baby. You don't have baby between. You know.
I like that. Okay.
That's how it is. No mercy. No. That's why we have so much. Somebody say, "Oh, yeah, so many artists here. How you can survive so much competition?" No. There is no even less competition than 15th century. Those days, or 17th century. Those days we have painters and stuff. Today, when everyone who grabbed the camera is photographer, everyone who take a brush is painter. No. I don't have any competitions.
Right.
Very little competitions.
Oh, and that's true, because like I think what guys like Steve Jobs did is that they enabled people to just express themselves faster.
Yeah.
Doesn't mean that they are a photographer.
Right.
Like I know photographers that can take a digital camera and can take an analog camera, a regular camera, and produce the same result. You know, mm-hmm. They're masters. They
mm-hmm.
know.
Mm-hmm.
I think we just have a bunch of enablers,
right.
And I think with the acceptance of mediocrity,
mm-hmm.
a lot of us have just said, "Oh, don't hate them; let them express themselves." But you're right.
But the expression is not equal art, you know. I can express, you know, by screaming or whatever, but it has nothing to do with art. Now, with this mediocrity, lots of nasty, bad artists are hiding behind this. everything is art, you know, behind the theory, writing right. about, excusing, explaining it, you know, what it is. No, no, I don't need the explanation. Your art has to talk to me directly.
Right.
I don't need the artist. That's why I don't believe in interviews and things like that. The painting has to talk. Degas, you know, the painter, Degas,
yeah.
he said once, he was giving advice to the young artist. What do you give the advice? He said to the young artist. Say, first thing you should do to the young artist in the beginning of his career is cut his tongue. And he's so right. Because today I never saw such a huge tongues in the
artist.
Oh artists.
My God. Like I said,
huge tongues and small brushes.
Right. I like I said, Steve Jobs, you know, God rest his soul, he did a good thing for us, but at the same time, too, it might be bad because he enabled a lot of people to have a bullhorn, to have nothing to say or say stuff
right.
that just can sometimes be disrespectful. Like, how can you disrespect history?
Yeah.
You know, you don't have to. You don't have to love it, but you can't disrespect it because it's gotten you
yeah.
here.
And that's also with the educational system in the whole country, come, you know? To respect history and stuff, you have to have education a little. You have to know what's good, what's bad. How many kids love to go to the Metropolitan, you know, if you don't force them and stuff? Or listen to good music like Love Supreme and instead of some stupid rap, you know, and think
right.
about... And go, yeah, to the history and stuff, which needs some effort on the part of the listener also. Involvement.
Right. Patience.
Patient. Like, what you need to see painting. So somebody say, what I need to understand the painting? How I should look at the painting? What I need for it? You need only one thing. Chair.
Wow.
Take the chair, sit there,
wow.
and try to connect.
Wow.
Because
that's
painter,
a good
one. I'm not going to be here after a century or two. This painting has to talk to you because I'm not there. You know, and that's how you know what's a strong painting. The painting has to, I call it, has some radiation. Some, how you call that? Some energy.
That, which that is, painting that Picasso made a long time ago called Four Musicians.
Uh huh.
That's one of my favorite paintings as a little kid.
Uh-huh.
And I remember the good thing about being in New York City, New York City schools will take you to the museums.
Yeah.
And I remember you sit there and I looked at that painting because they said, oh, choose a painting and go home and draw it.
Yeah.
And I sat there and those four musicians got up and started to move.
Uh-huh.
And they started to, you know, play and talk and stuff like that. And then when you go throughout the museum, they do talk to you.
Cool. Of course.
You know? And that's the way it's supposed to be.
Supposed, that's what they made. This is my talk conversation with unknown people out there. You know? They are made as a gift to the other. You know? For me, to you, to... That's my gift, you know? For you to get some different experience, to enrich you if it's possible. Or to give you some poetry, which is going to take you to some other place.
Right.
Or inspire you to do something, you know.
What do you think, when you say a statement like that, what do you think about the capitalism of art, all arts? Because I think the capitalism, yeah, you want to get paid, but I think it got to the point where you can't even get paid. And they dumbed it down for people to accept. You know what I mean by dumb it down? Like, you can't... Like I say sometimes, like this painting, you have something that looks like Jesus Christ's head is cut off.
What
and
mean?
Some people will freak out, but to me, I just see the beauty of...
Exactly, but you're lucky that you can... You're not prejudiced, mm-hmm. you know, and you let your imagination work, give the chance to the other possibilities of the image you see, you know. That's also come education. If you're raised on just this, you know, TV, church, religion,
yeah, straight
Trumpism kind of bloody whatever you call it, right away you go to something which somebody drill in your head. You know? Jesus, what Jesus, not only Jesus for me, this is plain, flying there. I can say this is the propeller going there. First of all, this painting was about the Icarus falling, you know?
Right.
Icarus. And people are going to say, why? Who is Icarus? And I like you to go and open mythology and read a little about Icarus, too. That's why I don't want to explain too much, too, in the paintings, you know? People want to be everything to be explained on a plate, you know?
Yeah.
But that's not the point of this, you know? I did the thing. This is my speech. This is my explanation.
Right.
You know? Now I want to hear you, what you get from it.
Yeah. So when you see someone bring a painting back to you and they tell you what they feel, how do you feel? Or are you just observing?
Well, always observing. I mean, I'm used now to any comments, you know? What I like the most rewarding is, remember when I had a... This doesn't happen here in Europe. I had one gallery in some countryside. It was there, and you have lots of farms there. What I like about Europe is when I had this show, the peasants, farmers passing by, and they go in a gallery. And they're not freaking out, but they're thinking, they're commenting, they're asking, you know. They're not coming to conclusion. So fast, right. I was amazed, you know, I liked that.
Find that more here in America?
Like you was telling me, what was it yesterday, if I go south, exhibit this, they're going to lynch me, who knows?
Yeah.
You know, or burn me there, yes, put the feathers on me.
Uh-huh.
Why? Without before...
It's lack of education, like you said.
Get the connection, you know, with the person. Or why judge right away? Because of the color or whatever.
So we're going to leave it there for that first part. We're going to bring on, for the second part, Stephen Bogue. His partner at this new show that they're putting together in March. We're going to give you all the information about the new show that's coming together. But if you want to get in touch with Robert Danadov or you want to see his artwork, go on Instagram and just type in Robert Danadov. Danadov is spelled Dandarov. Again, if you're trying to look for his artwork, go on Instagram and type in Robert Danadov, Dandarov, or you can check him out on his website at robertdanderoff.com. He does have a website, robertdanderoff.com. He paints in Brooklyn. We were at his warehouse studio in Brooklyn. An amazing painter. As you can see, he's got a really good heart. He does have some philosophies and opinions about art and how things got him to where he is right now. I think there's a lot of nuggets in there where you can probably take something from it. It also gives you, as a lover of art, you can hear in the conversation the real artist. And when you see his new show or the shows that will be coming up, when you see his artwork online, you now have an inside opinion, maybe, or inside track, or you see where it's coming from. You see the rawness, because we were coming from truth and honesty, and we spoke about his background and then philosophy and all these other different things, and just had some fun and had some wine. We were drinking Greffon wine. Hopefully, maybe one day we can get them guys on. It was pretty good. So there is a part two. We're going to cut it right here. Hope you enjoyed it. Leave your comments. Leave your positive comments. Not interested in your negative comments at all about the artist. Keep it clean. Keep it safe. You know, if you have some suggestions, that's different. You can hit me up on a DM. Again, I'm on Twitter at The Chris Complex, and we can always make things better. If you want to come on yourself, if you're interested in me having a conversation with you with art and wine, music, photography, whatever you're into, again, go back, hit me up at The Chris Complex on Twitter. We'll set it up and we'll get in there and we'll have some fun. And, you know, you can be a part of the conversation as well. So this is The Christopher Complex Show. We do everything on this show. We got some other interesting interviews, or rather conversations, coming up from all walks of life, all backgrounds, all professions. We just want to learn, build, and make you better. And just entertain and inspire you, and hopefully get you up off of that couch instead of looking at the dream on the wall. Get up and start building your dream. Start doing what you have to do. And we'll take it to the next level. So that's part one. We're going to start part two. Look for part two. Thank you for listening. Please subscribe and share. Please subscribe and share. Support the artist, Robert Danadov. And again, hit me up if you're interested in doing one yourself. Talk to you.